I've always loved river fishing. As a kid, my dad and I, we fished a lot of rivers, and it's just something about a river is that there's always so much going on, a lot of life in a river, you know, and that's really what makes up a good system, like let's just say the Winnebago system. The reason it's so fertile and so productive is because it's got so many rivers running in and out of it. And any time that you have current, and most of the time a river has pretty decent current, you're going to have a lot of life. You know, you're going to have a lot of frogs, you're going to have a lot of fish, you know, a lot of activity in the rivers. And there's always some type of fish in the rivers, and usually multiple species. So it's always fun because you never know when you set down what you're going to catch. And you can be very versatile. If you want to fish bass, you can start fishing bass. If you want to fish crappies, you can fish crappies. And that's kind of what we're going to do today. We're going to start off this week's show fishing crappies in the timber, and we'll see what happens. You know, a big thing when you're coming and you're fishing these crappies is to come in real quiet, because most of them are suspended through these trees, and there's a couple of fallen trees down here that you can't see. We just pick them up on the locator. So when you're coming up, I like to use the Minn Kota. Go real slow, come up to the tree, do not bump the tree at all. And so otherwise what you're gonna do is you're gonna spook them fish out of there. So we're just gonna slowly work our way up here. Then I'm gonna grab onto this branch and tie us up. And you can pretty much do this any time of year. You know, a lot of times, like on the Winnebago system and other bodies of water, the crappies will come into the bays and spawn into the bays and some of the channels. And then what happens through the course of the summer is they migrate actually back into the rivers, because the shiners are up here real thick, and that's their main forage right now is the shiners. So they'll come back up into the rivers, and that's what we're gonna do today. We're gonna be fishing crappies, and they're gonna be suspended, layered through the trees. And the big thing is when you're fishing these crappies is that, let's say you're in 8 feet of water and the branches are layered through there, never drop all the way down to the bottom right away, because what's gonna happen is you're gonna hook the fish, then crappies will layer all the way through the water column. What's gonna happen is you're gonna drop down, you're gonna hook a crappie on the bottom, you're gonna pull him all the way through them other fish, and he's gonna be going back and forth, and he's gonna spook all the other ones. So start from the top, 6 inches, maybe a foot down, work that, catch the fish at that part of the water column, and then again, go down another foot and keep working your way till you get down to the bottom, because you know, once you get down to the bottom, it's coming to an end. So that's a key thing too, don't spook the fish.
That's like this one.
Well, you know what they say, you gotta start somewhere. I just stuck it down in there. You know, today we're fishing with my oldest son, Sawyer, and he's telling me about all these 14, 15 inch crappies that he catches. I certainly hope that's not a 14 inch crappie.
No.
As you could see, I caught that fish way up into these trees here, and when I threw him back out into the current, because what happens with a crappie is they'll go back down into that cover right away if you throw them back in there and just sit there and shake, and it's like a warning sign, and it'll spook the other crappies. Crappies are very spooky, no doubt. Got him?
Oh, that's a nice one too. Ooh.
Nice fish. There's what we're looking for. All right. That is a nice crappie. That's a nice crappie right there. You know, that's probably a good solid 12 and a half inches. If it was mine, it'd be 14, of course, but since it's his. Not quite 14 inches, but we'll see.
It's a small one.
Keep talking about these 14, 15 inches.
When I just caught that crappie, and that plastic got a little bit torn, as you'll see right there, and it pulled down, the fish is not gonna hit that. It's done with, you know, just throw it away. And then when you grab another one, take it just like this. You kinda wanna size it up where it's gonna go on, you know, measure it up if you want it here. All right, you're gonna want it to come out, you know, right there. So put your finger right there, put it through. You want it to come out straight out the back. If it's off to the side a little bit or crooked, it's gonna swim differently, so you don't want that. and then push it all the way on so it looks like a nice clean presentation, just like that. Even we want to have a little bit more, just like that. Exactly what you're looking for. Because if it's off to the side, this is not perfectly straight, it's gonna swim differently and react different.
It's not gonna look natural.
No, you want a natural reaction.
Oh, you got your crappie. Get him. Oh, yeah. Not quite as big as that last one you got, and I'll explain this on what you're doing with that. Basically, you're just dead sticking with a fathead.
Yep, I'm just dead sticking it. I'm sitting right above the trees. As you can see right here, the trees are about 3 or 4 foot down, and I can't let them take it too much, otherwise they get wrapped up in the trees and it's done with. So you want to pull them out fast, and that way it doesn't spook the rest of the fish that's in that in those trees.
Oh, I just missed one right there. I had a minnow one before, now I went to this Kalen's plastic. And when this happens, there's a saying, I got my pants pulled down. So again, like Sawyer was saying, the presentation is the way that plastic is needs to go under has to be perfect. So that's exactly how you want to have it. And that just dangles when you're in the water like that. It just back and forth and just drives them crazy. He's running. He's there. There you go. All right. Kicking my butt this morning. No, that's not a bad crappie either. It's not, again, not 14 inches. Still a very nice fish. Hey.
Look at that.
What are you fishing for? It's not squirrel season. Hey, the only thing nice about now is when their kids are growing up like that. Years ago, when they come out fishing by themselves, they'd empty my tackle box out. At least now they have their own tackle boxes. And you know what? Sometimes I even pick a few things out of their tackle boxes. So I don't really mind when I see them losing their jigs in the trees now and their crankbaits. So it's not coming out of mine. See? Now I can see all that line gets in all them trees.
Yeah, right there. That's what happens.
You know, the great part about fishing some of the rivers, especially during a week like this, there's nobody out here. We haven't seen one single boat yet. And you know, there's a great value to that. Just, you know, the peace and quiet, being able to fish most of the spots that you go to, nobody there. Again, it kind of goes back to that. I don't think in the summer, a lot of these rivers get fished real hard. They get fished a lot harder, you know, in the spring and in the fall, which are traditional migration times. So this time of year, like I said before, there's always a lot of fish in a river. As long as there's any kind of flow going through there, the more current you have, I've always said this, the more fish that it's gonna pull up out of the lakes down below. So a year like this year, we've had quite a bit of rain on and off, and our water levels aren't too bad. Even though we're fishing now, we're going through a lot of shallow spots here, and that's kind of the nice part about running a flat bottom boat too, that you can make it through this kind of stuff. But you know, what a great way to spend the day. So just picking spots. Oh, that's a nice fish, Sawyer.
Oh, nice, yeah, that's fish. Real big.
Holy crapers, you got one to nut?
Yeah, let's net him.
Holy jackpots, they probably scared every fish there is. Yeah, that's a nice fish. Hold that one up. Hold that one up to the camera.
So I just cast the plastics. These are stinger shads. You can get them pretty much anywhere, really. And pretty much there's just trees and stumps, and I try to fish behind them, because that's where, you know, not as much current, and they sit there and just ambush the, you know, the minnows and stuff that come through. So I'll float it right next to it, or close as I can, and you usually get the big ones like that.
Oh, here we go. Oh, look at that crappie. Woo! That is a nice fish. Oh, you are not going to believe this. You can call it a bad knot, but that fish actually broke my line. Look at it, it's cut. Now, my eyes are getting bad, I'm gonna tell you that. But it did not slip, it actually cut the line. I've got 4 pound test on here, and that fish broke the line. It was a little too heavy. I should have tried nutting it. Oh my gosh. You know what, that was cool. do you got? That's a big fish. I'm gonna grab the net. Holy God. Don't let him snap you off. Boy, if that's a crappie, that's definitely the one we're looking for.
No sheep.
There it is?
Yep.
Oh, big crappie. Now that one, that one's a little bit white. Boy, you can tell it's hot out. Look at that crappie, lost all its color. Turned silver. You know, what we're doing here is basically we're looking for big crappies too. You're not gonna see the numbers in some of these spots when we're looking for these bigger fish. They're gonna be, you know, twos, threes at the most. And the spots are small spots. What we're doing is we're driving up the river here, and basically we're looking for any type of structure, the trees that are in water that ranges anywhere from about 4 to 7 foot. If we can get that water depth, we know there's probably gonna be fish there. If what's happening is these fish are hiding behind the current. The current's coming down this way, and these fish are sitting on the back sides a lot of time. If there isn't any current and you have like a hole in there or an eddy, the fish will sit on the front side of the timber that's laying there. And again, I can't stress enough is when you're fishing crappies and you're in, let's just say 6 feet of water, do not go down to the bottom right away. What happens is, again, you're gonna go down there and you're gonna catch the fish that are laying on the bottom, which are usually the fish that aren't as active. The feeders are usually up higher. And what happens is you hook them fish on the bottom, you're gonna pull them up through the active fish and you're gonna scatter them all. So what we do is we start at about less than a foot underneath the surface, start working our plastics like that. We're using long rods, you know, anywhere from a 9 to 12 foot rod, or like Sawyer's got on, he's got a bobber on, and basically we're just working that plastic shallow. He's got that bobber set at about 10 to 12 inches, the bait below the surface there, and it works out perfect. Again, we're looking for the active fish. That's the key to this whole scenario here. In any river, this whole thing will come into play here when you're looking for big crappie. Ooh, nice fish. There you go. Ooh, get him in. Ooh, nice fish. That's a better one for sure. Now it's a minnow bite. Before we were catching the bigger ones on plastics. Watch your other rod, he just bumped that too. Got it like that, right there. There you go. Another one, it's kicking my butt. Oh, that one's got her choked right down too. Holy moly. Since there's nobody in that spot, I think I'll shift into there.
See what happens.
Make sure that nobody else hoards in on you. I didn't say anything about hoarding in on the spot. Did you hear that? Oh, I'm just making sure that the crappies stay, you know, tuned in down there. So why he's putting a new minnow on his bait. I didn't say anything about hoarding in on the thing. Oh, this is, what is this? This is ridiculous.
Yes.
That's just a little one, but still. Hey fish, I'm here too.
Oh, nice one too.
Finally, it's my turn. I was starting to get a little lonely here. Holy cats. I just went to that plastic and yeah, I finally get to join the team here.
A lot of people always say, well, you know, why do you have so many different types of jigs and plastics and stuff like that? Well, they all kind of have their own purpose. Sometimes if you want it to have a nice fall rate, you're fishing like against a bank like this, and you want it to be in the strike zone longer, I'm gonna go with like a hair jig because it's gonna slow down it's in that current. It's not gonna drop in as fast. If I'm really getting on them also, and I don't wanna keep tying up or putting new, you know, live bait on or plastics that's pulling the pants down, I'm gonna go with the hair jig for sure. And then if it's kind of like a midsummer bite like we're on right now and you got a stained water, you're gonna wanna go with a brighter, a little bit bigger bait. So I usually go with the stinger shads, as you see right here. They're awesome. Tubes are good if you're vertical jigging. You can sit right over there. They open up a lot in the back, give a little bit more action, but they all have their kind of their place and their purpose. You know, on a day when the bite's really slow and your cold front just comes through, I'm gonna use, you know, sometimes the plastics or the hair jigs or the tubes just don't work. You know, you'll have to go with the live bait. So everything just kind of has its own purpose and day when you use it.
Mm-hmm. It is very hot today, I'll tell you that. You know what, and I'm kind of gotten, which doesn't happen a lot with me, I'm kind of got into my lazy mode here. So it's kind of nice relaxing today and crappie fishing on the river here. No, hardly any traffic coming by. Nice and quiet. I don't know, it's pretty hard to beat this. Except for you can turn that heat lamp down just a little bit. Oh, here we go. That, now that's a nice crappie. That's a nice one right there. You know, that's the biggest one that I caught today. And, you know, I've been struggling a little bit. Sawyer's been whooping me big time, but I also think it's because he's doing the guiding today and putting himself in the key spots. Now, I kind of snuck in on him. He had me way up here, which I've been fishing for the last 15 minutes and haven't even had a bite, and he's caught five or six back here. So I kind of snuck in on him and grabbed some of his plastics too. So the thing is, again, you know what, when it comes to fishing, I'll tell you what a great way to spend with your family, kids, neighbors, anybody. Fishing is definitely the way you should live your life.
When I'm crappie fishing, I have two rods I usually like to go with. I go with like a 5'6" ultralight, and I usually go with like a 10 to 14 foot longer, light sensitive rod. The reason for that is the longer rod, I can lift straight up and I can fish pockets and trees a lot better. And then when I do get a fish, I'm not pulling them over at that angle. You know, say there's a tree branch that's underneath the water, I can just pull them straight up and out. And then with the shorter rods, I can use, it's a lot better next to the boat, tighter spots. And also, you know, pockets that I can get closer to the boat.
You know, the big thing when you're fishing a lot of snags on a river, or a lot of times we drag right down the river for walleyes with half a crawler on, is that in order to make it through all the trees that are here and keep you from constantly being snagged and keep you fishing longer, and obviously you're gonna catch more fish, is that we use a lot of weedless jigs. And I prefer, there's a lot of different styles of weedless jigs, but I prefer the ones with the bristles on here, these plastic bristles. And what I do is, most of these jigs come with either 6 or 8 bristles. And what I'll do is, unless it's super snaggy, is I'll take off at least half of them. So I'll just take my knife and cut off half of them like that. There you go. And what happens if you got too many bristles on there, you miss a lot of fish. The other real key thing is, let's say you're dragging down a river and you're drifting down the river, and your line's at a 45 and you're going through the trees. When you're going through the trees, especially when you're walleye fishing, a walleye a lot of times is just a dead weight and it'll come with you. But when you're going through the trees, you gotta make sure that you can tell the difference between a fish and a tree, because if you're going through the trees and all of a sudden you pull forward, what happens is you're pulling the bristles down and exposing the barb of the hook, and you're gonna be snagged all the time. So it's real key to determine if it's a bite or if it's a snag. There we go. Now that one really hit it hard. Oops, little sucker. That one really hit it good, I'll tell you that. I'm gonna tell you something. I'm not hot today as far as the fishermen, but it is hot today. This is probably the hottest day we've had all summer. You know, and that's an interesting thing that people don't understand, is that, you know, we've had a couple of really cold springs and cold summers in a row. And what happens when you have them kind of conditions, especially like crappies and bluegills, they don't have real good spawn. So we're trying to be real conservative. We don't keep a lot of fish the next couple of years, just because our numbers are gonna be way down. You gotta remember, when you go 2 or 3 years and you have bad spawning conditions, you're missing them year classes. So the next couple years, it's going to be really crucial to let especially the bigger females go. So, you know, be conservative, only take what you need. You know, it's been an awesome day. The fishing was so-so. The fish we caught were definitely caught some quality crappies. it was awesome because I was with my son Sawyer, that we don't get to fish a lot together, my oldest boy. And the other part was, we really never saw more than one or two boats all day. It was nice and quiet. What a great way to spend the day. And you know what? Now it's my time. A little bit of power pop and a sandwich. You know, for Larry Smith Outdoors, it's a great day to be alive.
Dad, what are you doing?
Hey, it was a tough day today fishing on Lake Winnebago, but I can't think of a better way to wind down and relax and sharpen my skills than reading the Badger Sportsman. It's a far from working experience.